Let's take the data set, which is say 25.5. Let's take it to be 45 only. And this is some frequency, which is 2, 4, 6, 8. As I mentioned, this is a toy histogram, so I will draw some dummy graphs. Now, if I want to cover this histogram with a frequency polygon, I will introduce another point, which is one before this, and it will be of the same length of the class interval, so 25.5 to 30.5. So this point should be 20.5. Next point should be 50.5. So I have introduced another classes over these two. Each of the class interval, if you look at the class interval, each of them have length of 5. So all of them have equal class width. So I will introduce a class mark, which is the point here. And I will join this midpoint. Now if I introduce this histogram, and if I connect these points by straight lines, is a polygon which has the length which is similar, which has the area similar to the histogram, because this triangle is congruent to this triangle. Similarly, though it is not easy to visualize, but this triangle will be congruent to this triangle. So all the area that is covered will be same. Now this frequency polygon can also be drawn without histogram. So let us try to see if I can do it here. So if I don't want histogram, I have to erase these points and keep only the class marks. Kept only the class marks. Now you join lines connecting the two points. So this is the new frequency polygon that you have drawn, and the area under this frequency polygon will be same as the area under the histogram that I have drawn. So this is called frequency polygon. The main concept, and that is the third concept. The next concept is frequency ogives. So let us take a data where we will draw frequency polygon and frequency ogives. So before starting with frequency polygon ogives, let me define appropriately what is frequency polygon. Frequency polygon. Thank you. regular data. So the data should be numeric. What is a class mark? As I mentioned, so it is class mark, which is midpoint of the class interval, is upper class limit. Plus lower class limit upon 2, which is the midpoint of the class interval. Now there was a survey done by some company, which actually says the cost of living of certain families, and then they came up with the data for cost of living in this way. The number of weeks. So there are fixed set of data points, that is people, and we have conducted a survey, and it is say the cost of living is 140 to 150. Cost of living is 150 to 160. Then 160 to 170. And 170 to 180. Let us assume that it is not going beyond 180. So here the survey was conducted for 40 weeks. So the number, so in that particular family, the 140 to 150, that cost of living was there for 5 weeks. This is for 10 weeks. This is for 20 weeks. And then the 170 to 150 for 5 weeks. So the data sums up to 40. Now I want to draw a histogram corresponding to this. And I want to draw frequency polygon corresponding to this, and with this data I will introduce the concept of frequency ogives also. So let me draw the graph. So since the data is not starting from zero, so I will make a kink over here. Then because it is starting from 140 to 150, you can also see this is a continuous data. So I will start from 130 onwards, because I have to consider the other column also. So it's 140. Extend this line a bit further. And then because I want to take care of one more mean, which is 190. Now, as usual, I will draw a histogram for this. So for that, I need to create an appropriate scale. All are in multiples of 5. So I will take 5, 10, 15, 20. So according to our assumptions, I will draw a line which goes up to 5. Complete it. Then I will draw a line which goes up to 10. Complete this bin. two points are extra points, which are the class marks of the points that are not included in this data sets. So I have to draw a line which comes to this point, then I have to draw a line which goes to this point. Goes to this. This is a complete graph of frequency polygon. As I mentioned earlier, this triangle will be congruent to the other triangle. This triangle will be congruent to this triangle. If I draw it correctly, this triangle will be congruent to this triangle, and so on. So, the area under the frequency polygon and the area under histogram both are same. This is how we compute the class marks, and we can draw a frequency polygon. There is yet another interesting thing, that you can actually draw an increasing function of these frequencies. For that, we need to go to another thing, which is called cumulative frequency distribution. For this particular thing, what is a cumulative frequency distribution? Let us take the same data and try to do it again. Cumulative distribution. So the data is cost of living. We do it fast. One cost of living. 5 plus 10, that is 15 here. Then 15 plus 20, that will be 35 here. 35 plus 5, 40. So this is less than or equal to this. So this is less than or equal to type cumulative frequency. And I will use this cumulative frequency to say something about the distribution of this particular cost of living function. So I want to draw a graph for this cumulative distribution. So again, there will be data points like 140, 150, 160, 170, 180, and let us take one more, 190. So if you look at this, 140 takes the value 5, let us make it 10. Okay, now I have to be very careful because I have to go up to 40. So I will make it 10, 20, 30, and 40. So here somewhere that 5 will come, 15 will come, 25. So now I have to see. Now at 140, at 140 to 150, this thing takes the value 5. So I will mark it as 5. At 150, at 0.150, I will mark it as 5. Then 150 to 160, it takes the value 15. So see here. It takes the value 35 at 170. it's a numeric data, you have to consider the class width. So if the width is uniform, if the width is not uniform, we will scale the height proportionately for the varying width histogram, and we have seen that in one of the examples. Then there is a frequency polygon which also takes care of all these things. This is also for continuous data, and you have all these pieces in the frequency polygon also. In frequency ogive, we have in particular seen less than ogive, where we have actually constructed a cumulative distribution function for the data that is given to us. Now let us switch our attention to some of the measures which are non-graphical, but they are quite useful in practice. So these measures are measures of of my classes. In the beginning of this lecture, at the beginning of this lecture series, I have actually discussed about the measures of central tendency. Let us take one example before discussing the measures of central tendency. Let us say there are two people. There are two, one girl student called Sita, and there is another girl, another student called Geeta. They gave one exam. That there were 5 questions. Sita scored each question carries 10 marks. So Sita scored 10 marks in the first question, whereas Geeta scored 7 marks. Sita scored 8 marks, but Geeta scored 4 marks. 8 marks in the third question, but Geeta scored 10 marks in the next question. 9 marks. 7 marks. Now, based on the data available, it was asked to the teacher, tell me which student performs better. So, the teacher did some calculation. She actually said, okay, so let me take something like this. Let us see the average, let us take the total of this and see if who has performed better. So she actually did 10 plus 8 plus 8. So let me not do this. Let us try to do it this way. Is it visible? Let us try to do it this way. 10 plus 8 plus 8 plus 9 plus 7 is equal to 42. Let me make it larger. So this is the total for one candidate. 10 plus 8 plus 8 plus 7, 9 plus 7, 42. Then let us take another candidate where the total is 7 plus 4 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 41. Now the total, if you look at the total of both these candidates, one is 41, another one is 42. The teacher said, okay, Sita is performing better because she has a total of 42. But Geeta is performing okay, but slightly below Sita. But Sita said, no, I am performing much better than her. She said, you look at the marks. You look at the marks. You order them in the ascending order. So for example, Sita's marks, you look 7, 9, 8, 8, and 10. And you look at my marks. I got 4 in one of the things. I got 7 in something else. But I got 10s in 3. And then she said, if you look at this mark and this mark, is scored only one time. Right? So I am performing better than Sita. So what is the correct answer? Is the teacher's conclusion wrong? Or is Gita's conclusion wrong? Gita had shown two ways in which she has performed better. So what we have to understand here is both, all three of them are correct. Only thing is they are using different measures of central tendency. Let us see what measures of central tendency each of them is using. When you look at the teacher's calculation, so when the teacher says she has scored 42, she is actually saying that this girl has scored 42 divided by 5, which is 8.8. This girl, this is 8.2, which is Sita's total. Sita has scored 8.2 on an average. Gita, I think, let me see. So Gita scored 41.5, which is equal to 27 and 3. So Gita scored. So what this teacher was saying is 8.13 is the average score of Gita in the exam, and the average score per question for Sita was 8.2. Now when Gita started calculating, she arranged the data in the ascending order and she picked middle number for both of them. Then she was saying the median of our data, median of the data, that is the middle value of the data, is higher for Gita than Sita. Another thing that she said is Gita is scoring maximum number of times, 10, that is the maximum 10 score of Gita was 3 times, whereas Sita was not scoring 10 every time. Right. So this is called mode. So all of them are using different measures of central tendency. So let us understand what these measures denote and let us try to see, can we make any meaningful conclusion out of this data. So let us see what is mean field of the data first. This you might have seen several times. So let us define mean. So the mean or average of data seen the data, I mean, we have seen the data, we have seen the representation of the data. So this kind of data we call as a raw data. But we have also seen an organized representation of data where we were giving the frequency distribution. For example, let us take one data set where this marks of the students are given, and corresponding to each mark, the number of students are given. So in this case, let us say 10 is scored by 2 students, 15 is scored by 5 students, 20 is scored by 3 students, and you are asked to compute the mean of this data. This case can be handled easily. So for example, what is the length of the data set? It's 10. There are 10 values, of which 2 values are 10, 5 values are 15, 3 values are 20. So this essentially means I am actually taking value 10, 2 times 2 into 10, plus value 15, 5 times 5 into 15, plus the value 20, 3 times, so 3 into 20, divided by the number of data values that are 10, total number of values. So this should be equal to 155. You can just total it and see, by 10, which is equal to 15.5. That is the mean. So here I have used some formulation. Let us call this as x1, x2, and x3. Then corresponding to x1, there is something which is f1, f2, and f3. So what I did here, what is this number 10 denoting? f1 plus f2 plus f3. Right? So here, what I did is, I have derived a formula for this distribution. X bar is equal to, in this particular case, f1 into x1 plus f2 into x2 plus f3 into x3 upon f1 plus f2 plus f3. Right? So this is the formula. Let me generalize this formula for n data points. Here n is equal to 3. So what can be the formula? X bar for n data points will be summation over I equal to 1 to n fi xi upon summation over fi. This is the formula for a data set when it is given in the form of frequency distribution. What we have seen so far is the mean of the data have seen this case where we had 5 data points, there were 5 questions in our example. Median of the data is equal to the value of n plus 1 by 2th element. Or 2th position. If my n is even, then I have a problem in finding the exact middle element. So in that case, I will define median to be equal to the mean in the sense which we defined earlier of n by 2th, which will be an integer, and n by 2th plus 1 elements. Okay. Elements, or you can say the positions. This is the median. Let me demonstrate it through an example. So I have a data. Let me arrange the data in order. So 144. 148, 149, 150. I'm just taking the data, but I'm skipping middle values. Like 151, I have skipped. Then I'm taking 155. I'm taking 160. Okay. So now, how many elements are there? 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Right. So according to this formula, my n is odd. So there are 9 elements. So 9 plus 1 by 2th position I have to see, which is equal to the 5th position. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is the 5th position. So the median for this data will be 149. What if I have an even number data? So let us take 2, 5, 6, 7. According to this formulation, it is n by 2th position. So let us first calculate what is n. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. N is 6. So if my n is 6, n by 2th position will be 6 by 2, which is the 3rd position. So this is mean of 3rd position and 4th position. 6 and 7. So my median should be 6 plus 7 upon 2, which is equal to 6.5. So notice this median is not an element of the data, but in this case the median is an element of the data. Right? So there is a difference. If n is odd, median will always be an element of the data set. If n is even, the median is not an element of the data set. About ungrouped data. Now, even if the frequency distribution like for single values is given to you, you can calculate the median similarly. Let us focus our attention on the third measure of central tendency, that is the mode. So when Geeta used this measure of central tendency, what did she say? She said there are 10 marks. So I have scored 10 out of 10 thrice, whereas Sita didn't score 10 out of 10 thrice. She scored only once. This is the data. She scored only once. So I am performing better. So this is the measure of central tendency, which is mode. So now the mode of the data is the value. So let us define it. The mode of the data. Of the observation the data which is 2, 2, 4, 6, 8, 8. This is the data set that is given to you. Which distribution, which point you will call as mode? Because 8 is occurring twice, 2 is occurring twice. So in this case, both points are modes of the distribution. The distribution has two modes, but we will not worry about the bimodal distribution in this particular syllabus. So let us not worry about this. Whenever the data is given to you, you will always have one mode in the data set. On the same lines, if we are studying a group distribution, frequency distribution, because it is group, you cannot decide what is a mode. It is not possible to determine at the frequencies. So, in this case, if you want to determine the mode, you have to follow some procedure. So, you first locate the class. Has maximum frequency. If you locate the class which has maximum frequency, you call that class as, and you call it as modal class. This is modal class. So you have located, so this is the first step that you are doing. Located the modal class. Then, once you located the modal class, the mode is the value which is inside this class. Then, this modal value which you want to determine is given by. So, you just analyze the steps that I'm telling. Let's call this mode. So this you cannot determine in particular, but you can actually estimate this value. So what I will do is, if I have a class, then I will take the lower value of the class. Then this modal value will be according to frequencies. So what I will do is, I will take the frequency of the modal class. I will take the frequency of the class preceding the modal class. Then I will take the difference. Before putting this formula, I will take the difference, which is f1 minus f0. This is the preceding class, this is the succeeding class. So f1 minus f0. I will multiply this by the length of the class interval. So this is, let me rewrite the terms. L is equal to the lower class limit. I already explained this while writing the terms. Lower class. corresponding to model class is 8. Then succeeding the model class is 2. Preceding the model class, that is F0, is 7. So now we need to just combine all these things and calculate the mode of the distribution. So we just put the formula mode is equal to 3 plus 8 minus 7 upon F1 combined twice, so it will become 16 minus 7 minus 2. Then multiplied by 2 equal to 3 plus 2 by 7. Just check, it is 1. 7 will survive, 2 by 7, which is equal to 3.286. This is the mode of the distribution. Now there is a difference when it is a group data and when it is an ungrouped data. When it is an ungrouped data, the mode is essentially an element of the data set. When it is a group data, you are trying to approximate the data set, which is not an element. You are trying to approximate the mode of the data set. So this may not be an element of the data set. So this thing is not an element of a data set, because no family size can be in fractions.